Yes.
Cool. Right, then we'll wait for a minute or so, and then we can get started. Before I dive into the content, is there anybody who has a specific question or topic on his mind that they hope to get answered in this webinar? Everybody is too shy to speak now.
Effect. And the mute effect is the overhead of having to unmute just to say something small.
Well, that's okay. We'll go through the slides. If you have questions while we're doing the slides, feel free to interrupt and ask questions, right? I hope we can have some interactive discussion going on. I also hope we don't spend an hour just presenting the slides, so we can dive into some discussion. That would be nice. All right, that being said, let's get started. So welcome everybody to the Saving Costs on the Cloud Data Analytics Workload webinar. Before we dive into the content, first introduce who you see here. Who are we? Well, I'm Chris. I'm the founder and CEO of DataMinded. I mostly work on Amazon and Azure projects. I also got my Amazon Solution Architect certificate and Azure Solution Architect certificate. And right next to me on the couch with a meter and a half distance is Pascal. Pascal, maybe you can also introduce yourself.
Yeah, so I'm a data engineer with Chris's company here. I'm kind of a Google nerd, but mostly work on AWS because, well, most of the world works on AWS. I have a little bit of experience with Google clients as well. And yeah, we're going to talk about pros and cons. It doesn't necessarily mean that it is just one product of one vendor that is better, but it's more the abstraction levels that are really interesting.
Yeah, exactly. A quick word about who we are in DataMinded. I think most of you know us, but what we do at DataMinded is we build data solutions for companies mostly based here in Belgium. We work with enterprise customers a lot. I think a few of you are in the call. We also work with government. So we do like projects like Delayne or SNCB or Bpost, which is also a lot of fun. And then last but not least, we also work with startups where we help them get going in the data analytics space. And we do a lot of things in the cloud, if not all. There are a few customers of ours who are not in the cloud yet, but I think 99% of them are. We're big believers of the cloud. We believe cloud is transforming IT. We specifically didn't choose a specific cloud provider. Like, we didn't become like the Azure only shop or the Amazon only shop, because we believe we want to help our customers where they are. And some of our customers are on AWS, so we're advanced consulting partners of them. Some of our customers are on Azure, and others are on Google Cloud. And there's pros and cons to each of these clouds, right? So we're not here to market any one of these specific, but when we go into the use cases, there will be like Amazon specific use cases or Azure or Google specific use cases. One thing I'm really proud about at DataMinded is that we recently launched DataFi. What is DataFi? It's a managed analytics environment on which you can build your data products. And later on in the webinar, we'll also show how we apply the principles of cost savings in the cloud to the product that we launched, to DataFi. If you want to know more about DataFi, there is a URL there, get.datafi.cloud. You can register for the private beta, and I can get you onboarded, and I can get you to try out DataFi on your own. And if you see like, something that we could use, it might help our organization, and we can set it up for you. There's currently a few large customers running on DataFi already, most notably DPG Media and Calibra, which here in the Belgian space are like two quite cool companies to work for in general. And it's very nice to see that their workloads are running on DataFi. So if you want to get on the similar kind of analytics environment as these companies, then get in touch and we'll get you started. That being said, let's dive into the topic of the webinar, right? About how do we save costs in the cloud? Maybe Pascal, I'll let you give the executive summary already, and then if you guys in the audience know already what it's about, then you can skip the rest of the webinar and end here. And for the rest, we can dive deeper into the individual topics.
Yeah. Well, so I guess it's kind of obvious. If you work in the cloud, then welcome to the cloud. So you should probably also work as the cloud builders intended it. So that means in your private data center, you actually don't expect your VM to crash. But in the cloud, if you actually embrace that idea and you say, well, you know what, I'm going to let a bunch of VMs crash all the time, then you're going to pay a lot less. So maybe you should go that way. And then something else that is probably also coming from the on-prem environment is this DTAP. So you have a development, a test, an acceptance, and a production environment. Maybe it's not necessary to have them all running all the time. Maybe it's not necessary to have them all. So that's some things to look about, to think about. And then in terms of technology trade-offs, it's probably another key point. There isn't going to be this 50 other executive or CTOs chose this, so you should also choose that. That's not how this works, right? You can't make your decisions that way. So you have to have a good, smart team, evaluate the landscape, and then find what's right for you. And then finally, I think that's probably one of our core values also for clients is, first, you have to make money to save money, because it helps you not at all if you have a solution that's great on paper, but that never gets deployed and you never make any money. So it's always better to first earn a bunch of cash and then to say, well, okay, but probably we can do it a lot cheaper.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that one's also for me, I guess.
Yeah.
So there are a number of different things you should always consider, and cost is just one of them. If you just keep squeezing for costs, yeah, sure, you're probably going to have a very cheap cloud. But what's the point if the cloud is then, you're one of those people that has an open data lake, which is just accessible from the internet, or you have something where it goes down all the time, like GitHub today again went down.
Really?
Yeah. Christoph was kind of annoyed. So yeah, there's just one out of several components that you should think about. And so you always have to weigh these trades. You always have to weigh the pros and cons. That's exhausting, but unfortunately, that's the way we live.
Yeah, and why do we say that? Before we're going to talk a bunch about how can we save costs for cloud projects. But in the end, just keep in mind that whenever you're saving costs, you're doing this for a purpose, right? There is a lot more than cost reduction, but it's one component of a healthy architecture. This slide is actually more or less a copy-paste from the Amazon well-architected framework. I mean, they all have their own kind of frameworks at all. All comes down to the same thing, right? But this is an example that I found helpful. All right. So maybe, well, as a first tip of saving costs, it's about not lifting and shifting. Maybe can you explain a bit, Pascal, what you mean by don't do lifts and shift? Why does it save costs?
Well, a lift and shift, I guess, would be pretty obvious when you want to move your Hadoop cluster. Well, you want a bunch of VMs, and then you install Hadoop on all these VMs. And problem solved, right? But you're going to reinvent the wheel, and you're going to manage what essentially guys from Google or other cloud vendors are managing for you behind the scenes. So why do you want to manage the same thing and probably do it way less well as they do? If you can just have it be taken care of by them. But then this is still, they are basically giving the clients what they want, which is a lot of enterprise clients say, we have a Hadoop cluster and we want to bring that to the cloud. But if you look even further down that path and you keep walking that line, you'll discover that, okay, if I'm in a greenfield scenario and I don't have a Hadoop cluster to bring with me, then I can probably not even use Dataproc, which is still expensive compared to other cloud native alternatives. So we'll talk about that a little later.
Indeed. And this is one of those cases that if you're born in the cloud, then it goes without saying. But if you're like a larger enterprise, and you have a lot of legacy on-premise, this is a discussion we've had a lot of times with clients, like, hey, can we just copy-paste what we have on-premise to the cloud? And yes, you can do that. But then, like, if you do the calculations, like, hey, the cloud is 3 times more expensive than on-premise. Well, yeah, if you do it the on-premise way on the cloud, then not just about cost, but about all of the things, you're not creating a lot of value there. So try when you're going from on-prem to the cloud. I know like some vendors are pushing like just lift and shift and you'll be up and running in no time. We almost always recommend against that, unless there's a very particular use case for lifting and shifting. But by default, we say, oh, don't do that. As an example, maybe Pascal, you can walk us through this example.
Yeah, so we have a client that it's a small public company. And so they have MS SQL database on-premise, or actually I think it was sitting on Azure. So they're paying for the instance, which of course at night it's idling, it's a small company. And they were also paid about €1,000 in licensing costs. And so one of our colleagues moved all of that together with their team to BigQuery. And it turns out that the BigQuery free tier is so big that they're now at a 10-euro monthly bill, which to him, like, he felt a little guilty that shouldn't be that way. He's just like, how can we only pay them 10 euros? That just doesn't seem right. But there's also a warning tag attached to this, which is basically, if you query the wrong way on these technologies, then you're going to pay, because all of a sudden each query you pay for, instead of, well, it's my server, I can just, if I bring it to the knees, well, I broke my own server. But here, if you now query over your entire logs table and you keep running and you just say, oh, typo, oh no, maybe with this, maybe with that, and you don't limit it in some smart way and you have no alerts, then you might end up 1 month having, instead of 10 euros, a 200 euro bill because you had a very eager data scientist.
Yep.
But you're only going to do that once, and then you are probably going to set billing alerts and you'll control that.
Indeed. So that's a good one. Thanks for sharing that use case. The next one is think about when you go to the cloud, it's about scaling dynamically and this notion of cattle versus pets, or maybe even think about bees. So what do I mean with all these animals? Traditional infrastructure on premise, you often treat them as pets. Like, you even give your server a name, like this is Bobby or something, and Bobby needs a lot of attention, needs a lot of upgrades, a lot of patching. If Bobby is down, there is an issue, you're gonna drive in your car and make sure Bobby is up again. And these pets servers, they're very inflexible for the needs you have. Like, today your needs might be small, tomorrow your needs might be bigger or different. And so what a lot of companies do to counteract that is that they buy a lot of servers to begin with, very oversized the servers just in case they're going to scale, and then they have a few pets that they have to take care of. So an example of a pet is this 24/7 Hadoop cluster that you're running all the time and you need to keep upgraded and patched. Any kind of monolith application, right? Like this big Java application that you put on a VM, and then that VM is your website, for instance. Or like the example of a very expensive licensed database, often is treated as a pet as well. Now, what's different in the cloud is that you see more and more servers being treated like cattle. And cattle, you don't really care about an individual animal. You just tag them with an ID or something. You keep track of them. And as long as they're returning value for you, you keep them up and running. If they're not returning value anymore, you shut them down. And so you can scale up or down much more based on your needs. And you can tailor what you need based on business demand. So an example there is, instead of having a 24/7 Hadoop cluster, you spin up a cluster on demand, you run your workload, and you shut it down again. And that's very easy in the cloud these days. It's like, to have a Hadoop cluster in the cloud, it's one command, you spin it up, it's done. The same with auto-scaling VMs that you put behind a load balancer. You don't really care how many VMs there are. You just spin them up. If you see there's more load, more VMs will be created. If the load goes down, less VMs will be there. And Azure, Amazon and Google have something similar, but in Azure, you have this notion of a SQL serverless database. You just create one, and it will scale automatically based on the load that you have, which is pretty nice. And then as a next level, and I'm not sure if that's a great analogy, but it's the notion of having bees, where you go even one step further, where you don't even know or care how many of these processing units you have. In the end, you just throw a job in it and you hope it's done in the end. And maybe some bees might have died in the meantime. Like, if you're going to collect your honey, the honey might have been delivered by 1,000 bees or 2,000 bees, and 10 of them might have died or 100, but you honestly don't care. An example there is these typical Lambda functions, serverless instances that they create the moment the request comes in, and they get shut down immediately after. So you can create and run 1,000 Lambda instances all at the same time. You don't have to worry about any of that anymore. The same with AWS spot instances, which is this notice of, instead of provisioning a server and saying like, I need this kind of fixed capacity, you just go shopping on the market. It's like some kind of bidding thing where you shop for free capacity of Amazon. It's like, hey, I want servers, and the max I'm willing to pay is 10 cents. And as long as you can provision me these servers, give me these servers, and I'll use that for compute. And another example that, Pascal, you mentioned already is Google BigQuery, where honestly, I just fire a SQL query. And what happens behind the scenes, does it need 10 machines to process that query, 100 machines? I really don't care. It's pure magic as far as I'm concerned. What I do get is I get the result of the query back.
Mm. And these systems actually, they stop talking about instances, right? They start talking about units,
exactly.
Compute units. And you don't, with the B, you don't want to care about a broken wing. You just want to, if one's broken, give me another one. Next. But your favorite pet.
Yeah. And to make this very concrete, I made up a hypothetical scenario. If my slides want to go. Yeah. So imagine you want to do some heavy batch analytics on data using Spark. You've done some initial tests and you see like, look, I need 20 M4 X large instances on Amazon, which is about 80 CPUs and 320 gigabytes of RAM. And my process takes about 6 hours to run every night. Now, what kind of technology selection would I need? Well, first off, you don't need a 24/7 cluster, right? So we can just create a cluster every night, run the job and kill it. And ideally, if we can use those spot compute instances of Amazon to get compute at a steep discount, that would be very nice because it's going to save us a lot of money. So what are some of the tech choices? Like the popular alternatives out there is to either run it on Databricks notebooks, to run it on an EMR cluster, to use GluETL, we're talking about the Amazon ecosystem here, or to run it on Kubernetes. There are like a million other options, and a few ones I've discarded here is Cloudera, because in our opinion, it's a bit outdated. I don't see the value of Cloudera over any of the options on the left anymore. You could also run this on AWS Batch, but then you have to manually set up networking. You don't want to go there. You could also manually manage some EC2 instances, but that's also too much hassle. And now what we also see sometimes is that people use Lambda functions to do some quite heavy data processing. But Lambda functions, as great as they are, they're really just meant for small processing, right? So not for these large computes. So it would be too many constraints. The impact, like between making like the dumbest decision you can make and the smartest or the cheapest, is like a 98% cost savings. And that's quite significant. It does come with some extra complexity, but if we put this on the graph and we say here on the left, we look at some 24/7 instances, like a Databricks 24/7, an EMR 24/7, or Kubernetes, and we do the cost calculation on that, like what's my EC2 price, what is my service price, what is, sometimes you need some masternodes, what's the price of that? Like the most naive approach would cost you, for that compute, would cost you $10,000 a month. Well, if you already switch to just using on-demand instances, your cost dropped to like €1,000, maybe not even €2,000. And then if you go to spot, it's even cheaper, like a lot cheaper. And that, if you come back to this notion of pets versus cattle versus bees, that's this thing, right? If you, like, the worse you treat your servers, the cheaper they're gonna get. So the more to the right you can move, the better, typically. There are some caveats, right? The spot pricing fluctuates, so it's not that clear cut. Also, both EMR and Databricks claim that they can run your Spark code much faster than just your plain vanilla Spark, which indeed you might have some cost savings there. And then also GluETL, where you position that thing is debatable. Is that cattle or is that bee? But the point is not the exact numbers I print here, but the point is that the more you treat your servers like cattle or like bees, the more cost savings you will gain. And we see this over and over across different cloud providers. I have to be wary of time here. You go ahead.
Yeah, so then there's this concept of the, like, this DTAP, or what you call DTAP madness.
Yeah.
I actually had to Google this term, and then it turned out there was a blog article by Press Group or DPG Media. So it's funny how you end up being in your little bubble then sometimes. Yeah, so the situation here is that we brought these environments with us, but if you have a typical setup, so let's say you want to do some streaming, and I'll have another example later. So you want to do streaming, but you want to be cloud vendor agnostic. So you're not going to go on Kinesis or PubSub, but you're going to do Kafka. Obviously, everybody does Kafka. Well, but you have to actually process something, right? So what do you do the processing on? Kubernetes. And then you're going to have a Kubernetes cluster and a Kafka cluster in each of those environments. But you don't actually run stuff all the time on dev. You only do dev, well, 9 to 5, maybe 9 to 8, if you have really eager engineers. And testing and staging only when you release something. So what you should actually be doing is maybe, and this is another thing, if you have a dev environment that is continuously up and running,
you start on a Kafka cluster, you start having all these random topics, these engineering topics that are just flying around. Test Pascal, test this guy, test that guy. And then the integration environment is also running the entire time, but you just want to have it once. So an alternative way would be everybody gets their workbench. They run their code on those infrastructure components that they need when they need them. Terraform is probably something that I've learned over the last year and a half is really powerful that way. So me as an engineer, I want to test something on a Kubernetes cluster. Well, I do Terraform apply dash target. I target our Kubernetes cluster. And then I run my code and I kill it. The same for an integration test. We have one client that's actually went this far. Whenever they merge to master, they spin up their entire environment on a new project. So that's GCP. So they're running it in a new project, spinning everything up, running their integration tests on this completely new setup with Dataflow and PubSub, and then they're tearing it all down again. They wouldn't even need to tear it down because both of them are free. Dataflow is going to be free if you don't have any instances running. And PubSub is free because, well, you don't fire any new data in. But still, they're bringing it up, tearing it down. So they're testing everything from start to finish, and then they're tearing it all down. And so in the end, you only have one environment and not like most of us, four or even more environments continuously running 24/7.
Yeah, indeed, indeed. And that's it seems so obvious, but it's missed by a lot of enterprises. They take this notion from on-premise. Yeah, we have a development test acceptance problem environment. We need the same in cloud. Not necessarily. Maybe you do, maybe you don't. So technology trade-offs. That's a difficult one. Well, I always compare it to modes of transportation. And sometimes we see clients and they ask like, Chris, I wanna build a truck, or I need a truck. I want you to help me purchase a truck. But then you start asking questions like, but why do you need a truck? What a lot of companies forget also in their analytics use cases, you should start from your use case, start from the business need. So what are you trying to accomplish? That's the first thing you want to know. And then secondly, also what people sometimes forget is what are the skills of the team that you have available? So maybe you want to go for the moon, you need a rocket. But if none of your engineers has ever built a rocket before and you're very good at building cars, well, maybe you should reevaluate what you're trying to achieve or reevaluate the team that you have. But don't just assume that, okay, we've never gone to the moon, but so now this is important, so we're going to build a rocket and it will all work out. In IT terms, sometimes you see people like adopting Kubernetes like way too prematurely. We love Kubernetes, we do a lot with it, but it also has its trade-offs. It's quite complex. So for some of our customers, you say, look, we don't believe that the team that's onboarded here is ready to adopt Kubernetes, and we go for an easier solution. And then finally, as I said, what is the best trade-off in terms of the use case you have and the tech you have? Maybe you would like to have a Formula One car, but maybe a Volkswagen Beetle is good enough. You don't know, right? What you definitely shouldn't do in these technology debates is go into questions like, can problem X be solved by solution Y? The answer to the question is almost always yes. Where do we see this? If like a company has invested big in their data warehouse solution, which costs them millions, and then they want to solve everything with their $1 million data warehouse solution. But yeah, but can't you just make it work? Yes, you can make it work on a data warehouse, but it wouldn't help anybody, right? So you're not winning a lot. Also remember that engineering time is a lot more costly than technology cost. People tend to forget that they try to squeeze like €100 out of their technology license, but then they spent like 10 engineering days fixing it. But it takes a long time to get the €100 back then. As another very concrete example, let's say you want to build interactive dashboards on the AWS cloud, and your customer has about 7 terabytes of historical data with machine logs, click streams, and whatnot, and you want to build some dashboards. Well, the first thing that if they ask me that is the first thing I say is like, yeah, you probably need a SQL database. Because in SQL, with SQL databases, you can be very expressive in the query you want to have. Secondly, it's something that it's fast to query, right? Not every SQL database is fast to query. Some SQL databases are very good for inserts and updates, but not very much so for querying. And finally, when we see this kind of need, very often when they say we need to query 7 terabytes of data, most of it is historical, and only a bit of it is like of yesterday and the day before, and they care most about near real-time or real-time data. So what are the options here on the Amazon ecosystem? Again, you have Redshift, which is a data warehouse. You have Athena, which is something very similar to BigQuery. And then you have Redshift Spectrum, which is part of Redshift, but you can, just like Athena, you can query data that is stored in S3, which is a much slower storage thing. There are some options I wouldn't look at, like RDS, because it's not performant enough. Presto, it's not managed, so you don't want to go there. Oracle, Microsoft SQL Server, not always, but very often, if you sum up the license costs, it's crazy. And then you have like newer databases like Snowflake or Vertica, but then I discarded them here just for the sake of the example. You want to stay in the AWS ecosystem. Now, I didn't say like Snowflake is not good, right? I'm just saying here for this example, we're just going to stay in the ecosystem of Amazon. And then again, you can relatively easily save 88% of your data warehouse costs by just making a few trade-offs. And how would we do that? Well, simple. If we would go full-blown Redshift, that would cost us about 12,000 euro a month if you store all of that 7 terabyte in Redshift, right? If we would go full-blown Athena, we query everything with Athena, it's a lot cheaper. But then Athena is also slower. So what's the nice thing with Redshift Spectrum is that you can say, you know what, we're going to only keep the data of yesterday and today in Redshift, and all the older data we move to S3. So you have a very low-cost Redshift instance, and all the queries that you still need to run on Redshift Spectrum, that's not a lot, is also going to not cost you a lot of money. So you have both speed and low cost, and that's like one of the options. It's a bit more complex to set up, but definitely if you're into this area of I need dashboarding on large amounts of data with a lot of historical data, look into, if you're on Amazon, look into Redshift Spectrum, because it can save you a lot of money. All right. Just quickly, where do I see this being violated? Azure, I love Azure, right? But Cosmos DB is really being promoted as it can solve everything for everybody. It's global distribution, elastic scale out. It's guaranteed low latency. It's both a key value and column family and document and graph database. Really, you're really everything. It sounds like a cheap car salesman, right? I mean, and we've seen successes with Cosmos DB, but we've also seen companies spending thousands and thousands of dollars on Cosmos DB. Well, I think with a normal SQL database, they would have ended up with like maybe a bill of 200 euros a month or something. So don't believe all the hype that cloud vendors tell you. Make your own decisions on whether it's right for you. Finally, one more example, a positive example of Azure is I really like Azure Batch. We used this at the company, a customer of ours called Elaine. And then we process large amounts of IoT data in batch. And basically, the entire cluster setup costs about 1,000 euros per year, which is insanely cheap, right? There's nothing. It doesn't even register. So again, just Azure, just like an Amazon, look at what the pros and cons are. Make technology trade-offs in each of these services and make the right decision for your use case.
Yeah, so this is fun. Now you made a bunch of kind of examples of how to save money, and now I'm saying, well, honestly, why? I mean, what's the point in hyper-optimizing for 8,000 euros if you're not even earning that money to pay that bill? If you then look on the revenue side, if you add a reasonable amount of complexity to save maybe 20, 30% of costs, I wouldn't do that, because if you compare engineering costs to your infrastructure costs, it's almost always going to be an order of magnitude different. So you should really kind of figure out what is maybe a quick win that you can do some savings. So maybe you are having a whole bunch of metrics stored in CloudWatch, which costs you about 3,000 euros a month. That's never used, and so maybe you can get rid of that. But otherwise, if you shouldn't really spend your engineering team just sitting there for 2 weeks trying to figure out how can we maybe tweak a little bit more out of it. So if you jump to the next slide, if we look at this graph, the typical argument against serverless is quite often, well, it gets expensive really quickly, and then it becomes a lot more expensive than if you maybe have something more low level. So Kubernetes and Kafka combination, again, if you look at the bottom, you have the yellow and the blue lines there. And so they are cheaper both combined, meaning including an engineering cost or just the infrastructure. So just the infrastructure, and also if you include your engineers, it's a lot cheaper. Well, but if you look at the x-axis, look at the terabytes. I mean, okay, once you process 2,500 terabytes of data a month in a streaming fashion, then a 5-people team is actually, let's say, out-costed by your infrastructure. But honest to God, who's processing that much data in this call?
Yeah, and that's a good point that we see often at clients is they do this pure cost per terabyte comparison, say, hey, this solution is a lot more expensive than that solution. And they disregard like the engineering cost that goes with it, right? And that's what you show here. Maybe I can, I'll show you the next slide. Maybe you can explain this better than I do.
Yeah, so what I do here is I zoom in on the left side and I zoom in so far that you actually realize, or you can't realize, that these lines look like they're parallel. And if you look at the red line bound at the bottom, which is PubSub and data flow, just the infrastructure cost. Going from 0 to 30 terabytes, and 30 terabytes of business critical event data is a lot of information. If you're transferring 30 terabytes of useful data, that's going to generate a lot of insight. Sure, if you just transfer logs about your logging system that logged another logging system, which sometimes happens, then that you might quickly get there. But if you actually transfer events that are like they have a business kind of level usefulness, then 30 terabytes is an insane amount of information. And you barely get away from the bottom line. And the engineering costs, they're really the stuff that drives you up there. So this does come with an asterisk. It assumes that serverless saves you overhead, right? So it assumes that if you take the more abstract tool or the more abstract offering from the cloud vendors, then your engineers can focus more on what they're actually supposed to be doing. If you choose a serverless technology, which maybe not mature enough yet, or maybe it's just not the right tool, then they can also be in your way. But if you have one that all of the things that come out of the box with it are actually what you need anyways, monitoring, security, logging, auditing, all of that stuff, then engineers are just unfortunate. Well, good for me, very expensive.
Yeah, no, and this is another example of where you have to make trade-offs for each use case you make. So it's very hard if you come into a meeting, should we do PubSub and Dataflow, or should we Kafka? Or should we do Kafka and Kubernetes? It really depends on your use case. So you have to make these calculations for your own use case and see where you end up. In general, I do think that most companies exaggerate the amount of data they will be processing. Like what Pascal said, if you already process 30 terabytes of data, that's a lot for most Belgian companies.
Now you get to pitch.
Yeah. So maybe a quick word about DataFi. I mentioned already in the introduction. So DataFi is a way where we say, okay, we're going to accelerate data product development. What does that mean? And how did we apply these principles in DataFi? So DataFi allows you to run your Spark jobs or your Python jobs or your dbt jobs or whatever. And we've chosen as a platform for deploying our jobs on, we've chosen Kubernetes. And if you go back to one of these slides I showed you earlier about pets versus cattle versus bees, is that we let the customer choose to go either for on-demand Kubernetes or for spot instances on Kubernetes. And that's like, we're not choosing the cheapest per se, but we're choosing the ones with a very good technology trade-off between what you're paying and what you're getting. So today what's already in there is that, as I said, we do our processing on low-cost Kubernetes clusters. Each individual job you can tailor, say, hey, this job needs 20 gigabyte of RAM and 20 cores, and then we'll provision that for you. And there's also no need for this entire DTAP thing. We're allowing you to be very dynamic with the environments you spin up. So setting up a new environment is a matter of minutes. And if you don't need the environment anymore, you kill it. What we plan to do with DataFi in the future is that we want to monitor the actual usage, because we see a lot of engineers, they write like, oh, this job needs a terabyte of RAM. And then when it runs for 6 hours with a terabyte of RAM, you actually see like, yeah, really 200 gigabyte is the biggest peak you had. And like the other 800 gigabyte was just idling there. So we're going to give you some recommendations on where can you optimize the cloud costs. Yeah, and then what I said earlier, we're not married to any particular technology stack, right? So if tomorrow something new comes along, which it always does, I don't know what it is, but a few years from now, something new will come along again. And if we see that's a better fit, like, we will adopt that. And to give you a quick demo of what that looks like, if I escape the slides for a bit. So in Datafy, what you would see here, you would get a list of environments. Like, currently, it's only just a small dev environment or a demo environment, so you only see dev and test. But then if you go to one of these environments and you look at the deployments that are run there, or the events that happened, you see you can monitor what happens in each of these environments. You can go to Airflow, you see that the job has run there. You can go to the logs, etc. So this, what it does with Datafy, what Datafy does for you, is it gives you a nice overview of all the analytics projects you have deployed. Where are they running? How much resources are they consuming? You can go to the logs, etc., etc.
You should. These environments, they're virtual environments, right? So they're not full blown. This is a separate AWS account, and this is a separate Kubernetes cluster. But it's just the conceptual idea of, I'm in another space now.
Exactly, and it's good that you mentioned that. So in an environment, indeed, it maps to a namespace in Kubernetes. For those who know Kubernetes a bit, it's very easy to create new namespaces and kill them again. So you can work in your isolated environment. You do your thing, you shut it down again, just like you do a Git branch. And that saves you, just by being a bit more cautious about your environments, that alone saves you a lot of money. And then the fact that it runs on Kubernetes and it allows you to use spot instances, that's a especially for if you do more and more compute, that's a big big cost savings that you get there in the cloud. All right. So if I go back to the presentation, I made some screenshots because I'm always afraid of the demo effect or that it doesn't work. So I had some screenshots prepared. But I think it makes sense to go back to the conclusions of what we talked about. So Pascal.
So we're basically, we went through these three steps, right? So obviously you're in a new environment. So when in Rome, do as the Romans do?
Yeah.
So when you're in the cloud, work with the cloud technologies. And then this is probably something that, at least to me personally, I've seen this in the last couple of months. Make your trade-offs with a diverse team. So I think everybody kind of can resonate or can associate with that. Sometimes you have a very leading architect that kind of calls the shots, but if he's on the wrong track, that's a bad idea, because then you have the wrong ideas taking hold. So you should have a diverse team. You should really openly discuss all the alternatives, but you do need technical leadership at the end. When you chose your, as a team consensus, best idea, then you do need technical leadership that drives you to that goal. And so you should really consider all the trade-offs. And then once you plotted your path, you should go down that route.
Yeah.
And then finally, of course, well, if you don't earn money, then what's the point in playing?
Yeah, indeed. So that's the recap of the webinar. I hope it was helpful for you. Again, we don't want to tell you use this service and don't use that service, and this is better than that, or this cloud is better than that. But I hope we've given you some insights on how we reason about optimizing costs for our clients. So with that, I'd like to thank you very much for following along, and let us open up the floor for questions.
I guess you want to stop the recording first.
Yeah. All right. Anybody has a question?